Good evening. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the New York University School of Law and the 18th annual Tillinghast Lecture, which is held by the International Tax Program here at the law school. I am David Rosenblum. I am the director of the International Tax Program, known to some but not all of you. And tonight we have a very special guest as our speaker, an old friend of mine, Francisco Gil Diaz, a very, very distinguished man who has been finance minister of Mexico. He is currently the president of the Telefónica in Mexico and Central America. He is an academic. He has taught for many years at ITAM, which is one of the most distinguished institutions in Mexico, and a man whom I think you will really enjoy hearing, and we are just honored to have him here with us tonight. There are a large number of Mexican items in the news. One of my correspondents, and I'll leave it to some of you to guess who it is, advised me that I should begin by saying that tonight is the night of the football match between the United States and Mexico in Columbus. And I am told that there is a serious question whether Mexico is going to even make it to the World Cup following their loss to Honduras. So the minds of some of you may be on football, but I think we're going to hear some very interesting things about tax policy from Mr. Gil. Also, the other major item in the news that I don't think we're going to get into, but we may, is some of you may know that the current president of Mexico, Mr. Enrique Peña Nieto, has proposed some major revisions of Mexican tax laws only 2 days ago, including the abolition of the famous IETU tax, which has been the subject of two papers written by students of mine in the past 2 years, and also some major changes to the maquiladora regime. I don't know whether we're going to get to that. We may not, but it is very much in the news today. In any event, Mr. Gil Diaz is going to be talking to us about how federal revenue sharing in Mexico has emasculated local empowerment, and a few comments on customs reform and NAFTA as well. And so without further ado, I turn the floor over to Mr. Gil Diaz.
Thank you very much, David. It's quite an honor to be here at NYU and to be able to speak to this group. When I to be in the guest of the conference of David Tillinghast, which has such a tradition here at NYU, at the law school. When I was invited, I supposed, I think correctly, that the purpose of the invitation was to speak about international tax law. And I thought when Fernando Ruiz told me about the possible invitation, whether I should accept it or not, because I knew little about international tax law, and that small amount I knew I have completely forgotten. So I decided I would choose the subject and accept the invitation anyway, considering that there are some things that, even though they are more local, they have a general interest. And that's why I chose to speak about how the transition from the cumulative tax on sales, which is quite different from what you have in the States, one we had in Mexico many years ago, to the value-added tax, has changed the way tax revenue is shared amongst the federal government and the local governments, including the municipalities, and how that has changed the relationship between the citizenship or the citizenry and the municipal and state governments. And I think it's a profound issue that has a lot to do with public policies in general in Mexico, and maybe it has some interest for other countries who are interested in how to combine value-added taxation with revenue sharing under a federal type of organization like the one we have. Well, something else that I think is of potential interest, like David Rosenfeld said, to an international audience, is how we had to go and change quickly the way customs was managed in Mexico when we were expecting the entry. Well, not the entry, because at the time we didn't even know, but there was the intent of embarking on a negotiation of a free trade treaty with the United States and later on with Canada. It's something that the United States had been proposing for many years. And when Mexico finally decided it would like a free trade treaty, the United States balked. You know, what are you guys thinking? What do you mean you want a free trade treaty? The mood had changed in the States when we finally decided we did want it. But finally it came about, as we all know. Well, countries with a with a federal organization like ours, as I mentioned, may derive some lessons from our experiences. The new tax that was introduced many years ago was a change that was welcome, because we had an outdated tax structure. It brought about considerable improvements in the fiscal structure, but it also required another formula to distribute federal revenues. We shall see how, as a consequence of these innovations, the state governments and their citizens have become passive agents. People are now unable or indifferent to involve themselves in one of their most important public policy issues, which is public spending. Waste, leaping wage bills, and excessive debt are another corollary of the formula adopted. The first precedent for the value-added tax reform was an overhaul to indirect taxation that took place in 1970. Between 1970 and 1980, when the value-added tax was introduced, there was an evolution in the administrative prerogatives of state governments that led them to become predominantly processors of federal revenue. Constitutionally, the taxing powers of our levels of government mirror those of the US. The Mexican Constitution of 1857 copied a central feature of the US Constitution. It separated Mexico from the centralized political design of the Spanish colonization. Federal states were born with concurrent taxing powers. However, the new 19th century arrangement didn't go far enough. Municipalities were left out and have never been accorded sufficient elements for self-government nor taxing powers. This constitutional definition is useful to frame the substantial transformations undergone by Mexico's taxes. The tax reform continuum is the outcome of reforms initiated 43 years ago. At the beginning of 1970, there was a need to do something about the chaotic mosaic of state and federal indirect taxes. The reform undertaking sought to substantially raise revenue, to simplify the structure of indirect taxation, and to prevent state governments to compete for investments through tax concessions. The changes maintain at the outset the administrative tax prerogatives of the states, but require them to subordinate some of their constitutional rights in order to obtain larger federal transfers. This happened in combination with a substantial increase in federal indirect taxes. The new relationship between the two levels of government became thus a radical departure from the old scheme. A novel centralist approach was about to begin, with progressively negative consequences for the incentives state governments face regarding fiscal responsibility. Also, and perhaps of greater transcendence, public policy and expenditure decisions became even more distant from constituents. The 1970 reform performed the first of two drastic changes in the taxing faculties of the states. At that time, they were induced to relinquish their most important local revenue sources in exchange for a substantial increase in federal transfers. However, they kept their administrative functions as collectors of the federal tax. They would retain their share and pay up the amounts due to the federal government. Prior to this reform, there was a concurrent federal and state sales tax. They were based, these two taxes, on a turnover or cumulative design with no credit for tax paid on previous stages. Something completely different from what you have in state taxation in the states. In the states, in most states, what you have is a tax on the sale to the customer. You don't have a tax which applies on every stage of the production process. So you don't pay tax upon tax upon tax upon tax when the good is finally, or the service, delivered to the customer. The tax we had in Mexico was a cumulative, of the cumulative type. So the tax effectively paid at the end was substantially higher than the statutory rate. The state taxes mirror in their design and in their base the federal tax. The reform made upon this structure prepared the ground for an eventual introduction of the value of the tax. On this occasion, the states agreed to subordinate part of the sovereignty thanks to an offer designed in such a way none could refuse it. Because their revenue would increase substantially, piggybacking on a much higher federal consumption tax, they agreed to abandon their most important taxing power. The formula proposed by the federal government was ingenious. It was based on offering the states a larger portion of a bigger pie. Prior to the reform, with the same tax base and design, the state's turnover tax rate had been 1.2%, with the federal one at 1.8%. Since they were on the same base, you could add them up, so the addition of the two percentages was 3%. The proposed reform would increase the federal rate to 4%, an apparently timid increase, but its cumulative effect was equivalent to 13% of the value of consumer purchases. The reform also touched some excises and sharply raised their rates. A reform that has some resemblance to some of the changes that are being contemplated for the tax reform that was announced in the past few days. The income from the new federal 4% rate was to be divided equally between the federal government and the states, while administration would be shared. Because of their constitutionally backed prerogatives, the states could abstain from the coordination offered. But acceptance of the new arrangement meant a revenue increase of 66.7%, while a refusal implied no additional income with double taxation at the state level. As predicted, all the states accepted the offer and derogated their taxes. Together with the turnover tax, the country had accumulated a plethora of production and consumption taxes distorted of consumer choices, of productive investment decisions, and of exports. These considerations eventually led to the adoption of a value-added tax. From a purely efficiency public finance stance, the decision to adopt the new tax made sense. A turnover tax has several defects. It biases firms' decisions in favor of vertical integration. It's a way to avoid having to pay the tax on every single stage. It also taxes exports and investments. It produces an indeterminate rate of taxation because of the several productive and commercial stages before a product reaches the consumer. So you never knew how much tax a particular product or service paid compared to some other product or service. It depended very much on the structure of production prior to the good being sold. So looked at the angles from of added revenue and economic efficiency, the value of the tax was a success. It increased federal revenues. It eliminated the distorting effects of multiple taxation stages. And it zero-rated investment expenditures and exports. Because the states agreed to abolish hundreds of local taxes on agriculture, with the revenue lost incorporated into the revenue sharing fund, another benefit was the elimination of state restrictions to interstate traffic dating from the Spanish colony. The reform also simplified considerably the travails of taxpayers, since a considerable number of federal taxes were eliminated. The stamp tax, a relic from the 19th century, as well as an assortment of peculiar taxes on bases such as glass, tires, etc. With time, other taxes would be eliminated as well, such as a tax on soft drinks and a special tribute on mining. The latter unjustified because of the volatility of metals prices that provide either profit gluts or famines. The distortions to be corrected led the government to adopt the value-added tax. However, how Mexico evolved to the new tax and how the state's renunciation of their taxing powers contributed to extremely wasteful municipal and state governments is the gist of our story. It is a narrative full of lessons. Once the decision to migrate to a VAT was made, there was a need to determine the rate that would produce an amount of revenue equivalent to the income provided by the taxes to be eliminated. Beyond revenue considerations, the implication of the mechanics of the new tax for the distribution of taxing powers amongst the states was of greater transcendence. The reason is that to avoid a radical regional redistribution of tax revenues, a completely different revenue sharing formula needed to be adopted. The solution to this potential problem was the seed of an additional weakening of states' prerogatives, of profligate expenditures, and hence, paradoxically, of their plunge into financial woes. Differences in the regional distribution of tax collections were the source of a potential revenue sharing problem. The state income from a turnover tax is collected from the establishments where goods and services are sold and is attributed to that location. However, under a VAT, collections need to be made at corporate headquarters. It's the only way that the different credits that come from the former stages can be used in order to net out and pay only the net amount to the government. So the change would redistribute and concentrate revenue in four entities: the federal district, the state of Mexico, Nuevo León, and Jalisco. Because it would have been unfair and politically impossible to decrease the revenue of 28 states, a formula divorced from local collections had to be adopted. The new method used a simple rule. A general revenue fund would be created, taking federal revenue shared before the reform, plus revenue from local taxes to be eliminated. A general coefficient was created, dividing this sum by all federal tax revenue. The reform was sweetened by increasing the ratio. To determine local revenue, individual coefficients calculated using the same procedure would be applied to the newly created general revenue fund. The states would thus receive not only a greater sweetened share of federal tax income, but would share on the total amount and ride on its buoyancy, which was experiencing rapid increases because of rising oil prices. So you can imagine the situation at the time. The federal revenue and the states were really happy having all this additional income. It was a pretty substantial increase. It seemed like a good idea, and the states garnered substantial revenue increases. In 1979, before the entry of the VAT in 1980, revenue share was 13% of total federal non-financial revenue. It jumped to 34% last year. 34% compared to 13%, almost a threefold increase. The state's dependence ratio also rose substantially, as you might expect. 90% of state's fiscal resources are now obtained from revenue sharing and discretionary handouts. The public policy problem created with this succession of changes is that the relationship between taxpaying and expenditure accountability has been lost. With such an embarrassment of riches, the state governments and municipalities hardly bother to collect those taxes and service fees within their realm. Many have abolished or reduced the tax on the circulation of vehicles. Few or none make any effort to keep vehicle registration up to date. Few tax the wage bill or do it lightly, and only when their bulging current expenditures and heavy debt force them to. Nor do they take advantage of their legal possibility to add surcharges on gasoline and diesel sales. The same is true of their possibility to tax lotteries or to tax real estate or real estate transfers. The latter pertain to municipalities but depend on legislation by state congresses. Municipalities, in any case, hardly bother to administer their own tax bases or to charge efficiently for potable water distribution, waste management, etc. Under such an institutional arrangement, the bottoms-up benefits of federalism are impossible to achieve. Citizens assume a mostly passive role at the two critical levels of the political structure. The consequences of a top-down fiscal relationship are what one could expect. At the municipal level, the problems associated with lack of accountability worsen. One of the reasons is that municipal taxes are not a local prerogative. They have to be legislated by the states. As a consequence, citizens are removed from the decisions that allocate revenue from the states to the municipalities. Our political constitutional arrangement makes another contribution to this outcome. Municipal presidents are one term only and last merely 3 years. With a scant tax paying, municipal citizens have few incentives to participate in or complain about local expenditure decisions. Because most municipal expenditures are sourced from state revenue, there are few incentives to demand accountability. There is little interest for incumbents to respond to their constituents. Unable to seek re-election, a municipal president is more interested in looking at a political future as a state or federal legislature or as a bureaucrat. Three-year tenures with no re-election possible contribute to a short-term outlook, to lack of planning, to create waste, and foster a subservient attitude towards instances where anointments to other political appointments are made. Real estate tax revenues reflect the nonchalance of municipal citizens and governments regarding the comfort derived from revenue sharing. In relation to GDP, real estate income in Mexico was a mere 0.3%, a little less than 1/3% in 2010, only 1/10 of the equivalent percentage in Argentina. There are many other possible comparisons. I took one, but most would show the same type of contrast. The lack of municipal and state level accountability also contributed to debt excesses. At the end of 2012, the state debt amounted to $32 billion, not a burden at a national level. As a percentage of GDP, it reached only 2.5%, but a heavy load for the citizens of the most irresponsible state governments. Coahuila increased its debt 123 times. They like this succession, one, two, three, during the six-year term of its former governor. The state of Tabasco, 20 times. The state of Chiapas, 45 times. This happened within a six-year term. It's not a secular trend. It was something done at an incredibly fast pace. With more local crises to come, as hidden commitments come to life in these states and in others. Together with its shortcomings, revenue sharing with the states has been transformed into a web of diverse programs so complex that its overhaul could prove politically unfeasible. There are many different rules for assigning revenue, and each has a vested interest. Because of these perhaps insurmountable difficulties, reform of local finances should perhaps start at the most local level if one wishes to attain goals such as accountability, better resource allocation, and citizens' involvement in public issues. The ideal political unit for this purpose is the much neglected municipal level. But to become an instance with intense empowerment and participation, municipalities need profound reforms that require constitutional changes. A three-year term limit has to be extended. Re-election has to be possible to provide local presidents with a long-term outlook and mechanisms for removal of corrupt or incompetent, sometimes the two go together, public officials have to be established. Furthermore, the cabildos or town councils should be able to legislate real estate taxes and service fees. Since their revenue base potential is high, a reform of this sort should contribute to improve municipal services and to provide them with a closer fit to what people need. Higher voter participation at this level will also raise civic consciousness, which could eventually percolate into higher levels. Now I go into the other schizophrenic choice I made for this conference, which has to do with some of the administrative reforms we had to make in order to be able to go into NAFTA. When we were entrusted with this responsibility, of course, we didn't know what was going on at the president's level regarding his intent to engage in a free trade agreement. But suddenly in June of the first year of that government, I got a call from Secretary Aspe telling me the president has decided to hand over customs to you. I had asked Pedro when he invited me to become the Undersecretary of Revenue not to entrust me with customs. It was almost a condition. And then suddenly I wake up with customs on my lap. But anyway, at that point, my only choice was to resign or to resign myself to that fate. So I decided to see what could be done. And since customs is also is tightly related to the value-added tax, it also has a connection with the previous discussion. Value-added taxes are collected at the border to be credited in subsequent commercial exchanges. Half, to see how important this is, of the value-added tax is collected at the border, 50% of the tax. With tariffs plunged to the bottom as a result of tax treaties, we have 12 treaties with 44 countries, more than twice as many as China's and four times more than Brazil's. And unilateral tariff reductions, The value of tax is the main source now of Mexico's border revenue. In Mexico, customs administrative reform was, as I mentioned before, intimately related to our entry into NAFTA. Prior to NAFTA, merchandise dispatch procedures were in a dismal situation. They were slow, discretionary, rife with corruption, and with excessive costs. There was an implicit understanding prior to the negotiation of NAFTA that a substantial transformation of Mexico's customs was indispensable. It is therefore instructive and interesting to observe the state of customs procedures prior to the reform. There is no question that their design was optimal according to their objective. The requirements hosted upon importers up to 1970 were highly efficient when you consider their purpose. They were designed to maximize discretion, minimize control, and to maximize corruption. Take, for instance, the physical setup of the buildings. Instead of beside the border or the Rio Bravo as they are today, they were invariably a few blocks inside urban areas. After crossing the border, trucks were able to take left or right turns before arriving at customs buildings. Only the ones that really wanted to arrive at the customs building arrived. But these evasions were convenient for only some type of merchandise. All sorts of irregularities could easily bypass customs once in front of the formal dispatch. The concern about a customs impediment to NAFTA led to a mandate to modernize it. The first logical action for novices like us was to get acquainted with its processes. So we visited the entry point with the greatest volume of traffic and complications, Nuevo Laredo. I don't know if you're aware, many Americans are not, and many Mexicans also, of the intensity of border trade between the two countries. Just personal crossings, and I'm not counting the illegal ones. I mean, Americans going to Mexico. Are a little more than 300 million per year. It's the busiest border in the world in terms of personal traffic. So, Nuevo Laredo, where one third of Mexico's northern land traffic takes place, is the place where we decided to make our visit. If you look at a map of the United States and Mexico, Nuevo Laredo is at the end of a cone in Texas. And Texas is a large country thanks to the invention of air conditioning. There are many people living in Texas now. And there is a lot of growth and economic activity. But not only Texas commerce goes through Laredo, also a lot of trade from the rest of the United States. So as I mentioned, once we inspected the place, we discovered this brilliant design that had taken place to make cargo hostage to extortion. 30,000 trucks cross the border every day at that time. Every single day. The law required an inspection of each truck. Also, there was a voluminous batch of documents per truck that had to be inspected before cargo was allowed to continue. Payment of duties was allowed only after documents were cleared. The supposed inspection of the merchandise and the acceptance by the authority that everything was in order. So documents were released only after merchandise was supposedly inspected and the documents were cleared. Well, with these requirements, with these conditions, they devised a clever process. Document revision took place across 14 tables aligned across the corridor. And this design was repeated in every single customs crossing point. The dispatcher, the person who came with the truck and the sheaf of documents, would approach the first table and have the inspector in charge skim over the first document. Giving a preset bribe, the bundle would pass to table two. If not, the process would simply stop at table one. Table two required a similar amount to pass to table three, and so on. The sum accrued amounted to $50 per truck, or $350 million per year just for Laredo. I'm counting, of course, the not Saturdays and Sundays, nor holidays. Since Nuevo Laredo accounts for one-third of northern traffic, the national yearly take for the U.S.-Mexico border may have been in the order of $1.1 billion, just for the northern border, plus airports and seaports and so on. The money would be put in, I don't remember if it was the left or the right pocket. And you would have to put it into a bundle at the end of the day called the chicken, la polla. How do you call a chicken, a female chicken in English? A hen, a hen. It would be put into a hen. And everybody who collected bribes would put money into the hen. If you put the money into the wrong pocket and you were detected, that was your last day of work and your last day on this earth. They were pretty efficient at punishing infractors. So the system worked pretty well. During this first visit, we questioned the customs administrator about possible fines and penalties if a manifesto omission was found. His response was, the importer has to pay the duties omitted. So all the importer has to do is pay up the amount it is supposed to pay anyway, we asked. The response was that nothing more could be done because the merchandise had not yet legally entered the country, which was true. Well, with information from this first visit, we set about to immediately change the process. It is almost a truism that good corporate management requires identifying key end-to-end processes to have them streamlined and efficiently operated. This is perhaps more important when dealing with bureaucratic administrative processes rife with discretion. The modifications were the following. Duties would have to be paid before cargo entered the country. That way, since a paid tax return has been submitted, omissions and outright fraud become punishable, notwithstanding that the merchandise has not exited customs. A really simple thing, but it didn't happen before. Second, the 14 tables were eliminated. There is no need to detain cargo to force document revision, since after goods clear, customs, the broker, and the importer remain liable for irregularities and taxes omitted. And that is true for several years, so there is plenty of time to look carefully into the documents and find out if something strange was going on. That way, trucks or trains or ships could no longer be held hostage in order to collect a bribe. A random selection mechanism was established to eliminate the supposed need to examine all cargo. Random selection is sufficient as a fraud deterrent because a single grave omission can lead to the cancellation of a customs broker license, a highly profitable privilege, and or the incarceration of the customs broker and the importer. So just by a risk calculation, if the method is done properly, they would not dare evade taxes or alter their manifestos. These simple quick hits increased substantially border revenue from 1 month to the next, 30%, just 1 month after the other. The flow of illicit cash was also substantially curtailed. An episode is quite telling. A few weeks after the new methods were in force, we made one of our weekly surprise visits, in this occasion to the city of Matamoros. The customs house was located beside the river, one of the few that was actually beside the river, 500 meters from the Black Bridge, El Puente Negro, that takes you from Brownsville into Matamoros. When walking along this route, we noticed that all the buildings in the opposite side of the river were abandoned and their windows boarded up. It looked like one of those fake Hollywood setups for a film. We asked why, and were told that prior to the new procedures, only a few weeks before, these buildings had thriving whorehouses and bars. With time, more changes were introduced. Customs brokers were required to digitalize all the information required for a dispatch and to interact in real time with customs computers. We relied for this change and for many, for the others that I will quickly enumerate, on information technology, of course. Greater control was achieved when all pertinent information to border crossings was required to reside in customs computers before the initiation of the dispatch and before a truck could enter customs premises. A code bar was added to the document that a trucker presents when crossing, where their information is recognized in real time by the government's computer. This way, the same paid declaration cannot be used more than once. Buildings were moved to the edge of the border, and all procedures underwent a complete computerization. The fiscal police were revamped. Former members were given the opportunity to comply with the new rules. The requirements included physical fitness. Most of them were quite chubby. No drug addiction. I remember a member of the fiscal police in Tijuana who underwent a polygraph test. We submitted all of them to polygraph tests. And he was famous for being so corrupt and violent. And when he came out of the polygraph test, his fellow members of the police group in Tijuana asked him, "Pancho, how did you do?" And he was so happy. He said, "I passed." And they said, "How could you have passed?" He said, "Well, they asked me if I use drugs, and I said, yes. They asked me if I accepted bribes, and I said, yes. So I passed." And he did. Well, not a single member of the 2300 force passed. Either they were not able to pass the physical tests, or they failed the polygraph, or they were taking drugs. We hired a new group, really young people, and sent them to a training camp in the south of Mexico with the army, and had them prepare secretly. We really needed only a third of the former number, and we gave them very nice uniforms. We gave them their own weapons. We gave them a good salary, and also we paid them for their travel expenses. Before, the members of the fiscal police were so gracious that they provided everything out of their own meager pockets. their salaries were a fraction of the new salaries, and yet they were able to finance Suburbans very well painted with their lights on the roof, their weapons. There was even one commander of the fiscal police in the northwest of Mexico. When I visited that place, and discovered a landing strip, who had financed with his own income the landing strip for airplanes. So you see, they were gracious and they were generous, very nice people. Well, what we did with these new members was to establish a continuous rotation. It was devised in such a way that every 2 weeks they were told, now if you're in Tijuana, you're going to go to San Luis Rio Colorado, and B is going to go to Ensenada, and C is going to go to Tecate, and so on and so forth. So they were told in a completely unexpected way that they would distribute themselves radially to neighboring customs places. And since this happened every 2 or 3 weeks, they moved all the time. They were unable to establish liaisons with the local clientels, and amongst themselves. Well, unfortunately, this was suspended after we left, but for a time, it worked really well, because of course they couldn't get married. So when they wanted to be married and they became a little older, they left the force. And we kept replenishing it with freshly trained people that were completely new and would be inserted into the corporation. But as I mentioned, this feature of the fiscal police, it was abandoned later. I don't know why, but I think it was a bad decision. Intelligence was also programmed into the random selection of the merchandise once the computer was used for this purpose. Goods with greater security issues, health or tax evasion risks, have greater possibilities of being inspected. So you don't waste time inspecting goods, merchandise that do not entail a high risk. We introduced something that is quite novel in customs dispatches, which was to submit for bidding a second inspection to the private sector. So there is a second inspection done by the private sector, which has no legal binding results. It couldn't have, because it's done by the private sector. But it's an inspection on the first inspection. Since 1/10 of goods are inspected, 1/100 of goods are subject to the second inspection. It's a really small amount. And they can tell if the first inspection was loyal, if it was correct. So it helps keep honest the inspectors of the first inspection. Audit collections and other areas where the overlapping procedures and potential synergies between customs and internal revenue were transferred to internal revenue with substantial cost savings and increased efficiency. Well, the steps described show how discretionary authority has gradually been eliminated. Other steps in this direction have been the random selection of the individual that performs merchandise inspections, his identification through digital thumb recognition, the authorization for trucks to cross the customs area through a computer activation of physical barriers to entry and exit, the centralized revision of documents submitted instead of as before at the point of entry, etc. In summary, the reform came just in time for NAFTA. That's about it, both Davids. Thank you so much again for the invitation. And I think we have a few minutes for questions and hopefully answers as well.
Do we have any questions from the audience? I think there are a couple of themes that were sounded tonight that are certainly relevant in the U.S. context. Just let me start by mentioning that my personal opinion is that the United States is definitely going to have to consider a VAT at some point in its future. It's a subject that, as I explained to Francisco earlier, our Senate doesn't even want to talk about, much less vote on. But I personally don't see any way that that's going to be avoidable. So the relationship, the VAT, of course, raises all these issues of federalism, not precisely the same as in the Mexican context, but in our own context. And then the second piece of Francisco's presentation, I think there are different ways of dealing with corruption. Given my own career in international taxation, corruption has been not so much in the United States, although it's not absent in the United States, but throughout the world, it's been a constant problem in international tax and how to administer tax systems. We, of course, in the United States have made the choice of attempting to describe everything in detail in our code, which is kind of an insane proposition, but that's the way we've gone. Any event, those are my thoughts. Are there questions that we can take from the audience, from anyone? Anyone want to raise anything? Yes, Les.
So one comment and a question. First, the comment is that you described the revamping of the customs system and the fiscal police, and I think I had followed this when it was happening through some of your colleagues, and it is a remarkable achievement, and you all should be congratulated. I think to be able to deal with that situation in what was at the time a very successful way is a public policy achievement that I hope you and your colleagues are very proud of. So that's the comment. And the question is on revenue sharing. I wasn't clear whether the revenue sharing was just the VAT revenues or also involved other revenues. And if it involved other revenues, my question is, how does Pemex's revenues factor into revenue sharing? And with the new proposed change in taxation of Pemex, how might that affect revenue sharing? And just for the group, Pemex provides a very significant part of the revenues for the United Mexican States.
Okay, thank you for the question. At the time, I wasn't quite aware, even though I was not at all happy with the idea of having customs transferred to our department, until the president decided to have my wife and each of my children, together with myself, to have presidential guards following us all the time. But that gave us some comfort, because they were very nice people. But anyway, yes, the revenue share is all revenue, including oil revenue. And this poses a question now that Pemex is going to be charged a lower tax. What's going to happen to the revenue share by the states? Because they are going to feel cheated out of some of the income they were expecting to obtain. And that's also part of the explanation why revenue rose so much. So it poses a lot of issues going forward if this reform is approved, and I think it will, as to how revenue sharing is going to be handled. There are some changes I haven't looked into with detail related to empowering more of the states and to encouraging municipalities to raise revenue. I don't know how that has been designed. I don't know how it is going to work, but I think there are changes in the right direction. I don't know if I left something out.
Yes.
You spoke about the propensity of the states to take on high levels of debt and to raise their debt load to avoid some of the reforms that might have been available to them. Do you think that, or my question is it still sustainable for the states to continue to raise their debt levels, and is that still available to them to maybe put off some of the other reforms?
Well, it's sustainable at the national level. It's not a burden that cannot be absorbed, but it is a problem for some of the states, and some of them have had to slash expenditures and to raise some rates on their taxes or to introduce new taxes, and they are doing it because the government announced, fortunately, that there was not going to be a rescue of highly indebted states. So the moral hazard issue of going to rescue some of these profligates is fortunately not there.
Any other questions? Well, in that event, I'm going to thank our speaker, Mr. Gil Diaz, for a wonderful presentation.